This week in Virology, the podcast about viruses, the kind that make you sick. It's time for This Week in Virology. This is episode number 276, recorded on January 31st, 2014. Hi, everybody. I'm Vincent Racaniello, and you are listening to TWiV, the podcast all about viruses. Today, I am coming to you from Loyola University Medical Center. Yay!
Hey. Yay!
Which is, it's in Maywood, Illinois, and it's close to Chicago. And I've been visiting here to give a seminar, and I've grabbed two of the virologists here in the Department of Microbiology and Immunology. And starting all the way, and that's where, we have a we have an enthusiastic audience from this department mainly, is that right? You're all from M&I, which happens to be the same name as my department at Columbia in New York City, Microbiology and Immunology. How about that? So my guest today, all the way on my right, she is a professor in this department at Loyola University, Susan Baker.
Thank you. Happy to be here, Vincent.
Welcome to TWiV.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for inviting me, and thank you for agreeing to be recorded and seen by thousands of people.
Egad.
Around the world. My second guest on my right is also a professor in microbiology and immunology, Tom Gallagher.
Great to be here.
Great to be here.
Thanks for asking me, Vince.
Sure, my pleasure. I could not resist having two coronavirologists on TWiV. We have had one now and then in isolation, but never two. And so Susan and Tom both work on these interesting viruses, which are always in the news now, it seems, for the last 10 years. And we'll talk a little bit about those. And I must say, you guys are really lucky to have in one department not only multiple virologists, there are five, right?
There's five virologists here.
And I see one of them right here.
So we have Susan Upritchard, who works on hepatitis C virus. Ed Campbell, who works on HIV and restriction factors to HIV. Right. Chris Wietoff, who works on adenoviruses. And then Tom and I. But Tom's really viral entry, and I'm more viral replication. But we happen to work on the most interesting virus, which is coronavirus. So
You're lucky in one department to have two people working on the same virus family, because everywhere else it's pretty much, with the exception of HIV, I would bet, where there are probably multiple people in departments. You know, I've been the sole polio picorna virologist in my department, and while it's fine to have other virologists, it's always nice to have someone who really thinks.
Great. It's great. So we lucky. Work together. We meet together. It's
so you talk to
lovely.
Each other.
We talk to each other.
We're talking to each other now.
All right.
So it's great.
Let's start by finding out where you're from and how you, what was your path here today. And so, Susan, where are you from originally?
I grew up in Minnesota, in the Midwest, so I'm used to the cold weather. And then I did my bachelor's work at a small liberal arts college, St. Olaf College, so I have to give a shout out to St. Olaf.
Where's that?
In Northfield, Minnesota. And then I did my PhD work at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. And then I moved out to Los Angeles, did my postdoctoral work with Michael Lai at University of Southern California, and then came to Chicago for my, joined the department as an assistant professor, and have been here ever since.
So your PhD was with?
Sue Moyer, working on Sendai virus, negative strand RNA virus, at Vanderbilt, studying replication of Sendai virus.
And then you decided to move to the opposite polarity.
Opposite polarity, you know, to get that background. Kind of like you, you moved from influenza
That's
to
right.
picorna. So I moved from Sendai virus, negative strand RNA virus, to coronaviruses, again, to study replication.
And while you were in Michael Lai's lab, you encountered my first graduate student,
Nicola LaMonica. Yeah. Wonderful person and really a great colleague. And I was very fortunate. We had a number of great colleagues there. Ralph Barrick, who's now a professor at UNC. Shinji Makino, who's now at Galveston. Kyoko Yokomori, who's now at UC Irvine. So science is a small world, and we all keep in touch with each other, and it's a great thing.
It sure is, yeah. Tom, where are you from?
Well, let's see, my pathway here, going way back,
also?
I am not from the Midwest. I had a very, I guess you'd say, fortunate childhood. I grew up in Southern California, and right where the Santa Monica Mountains meet the sea. So if you're if you have an intrinsic love of nature, like I think I do, it was certainly certainly deepened by.
Is this part of California where you could ski in the morning and surf in the afternoon?
Well, potentially you could. That wasn't part of my daily routine, but I guess you could.
Because we have a listener, a retired biochemist who listens to TWiV, and he says he skis in the morning in California and then goes to the beach and surfs. So that. Mm-hmm.
You can do that, so it's beautiful.
So you grew up in Southern California.
And I went to college at the University of California at Santa Barbara.
So beautiful
stayed
place.
Stayed in the same area.
Nice.
And from there, I went back to Los Angeles, and I got a job at a company. It was called Diagnostics Products Corporation, and they provided a great service. They developed assays for clinical diagnosis of, you know, hormone levels and the like. And I liked that job and thought I might even stay in LA. Being a native Californian, it's tough to leave, but I decided I wanted more, so I went to graduate school at a place that I thought was exotic, Wisconsin, the University of Wisconsin. And it was a great move because I got to work in Roland Rickert's lab, a coronavirologist. And so I'm sure you know Roland.
Yeah, yeah.
And,
you must know Ann Palmenberg.
I know Ann, sure.
So I did a TWiV with her last year and explored her whole history at Madison.
I felt so fortunate to be in that lab.
So you're actually in Roland's, you're his postdoc?
His student.
PhD student.
PhD student.
Wow.
And I don't know if y'all know Roland, but Roland and Ann and the group at Wisconsin, just a bunch of really stand up, straight shooters, the kind of people I wanted to be around. And so I think that.
What virus
solidified.
Did you work on?
I worked on a Nota virus. Right. Small RNA insect virus. We thought about your work at the time, in fact, because during
nice
when I was there, we were working on making an infectious cDNA of the Nota virus, and that was at a time when it was a big deal to make infectious
cDNAs. Well, Nota is in the news again because it was used to show that mammalian cells may have an antiviral RNAi defense.
Right, mm-hmm, right. Mm-hmm.
Because with Nota, you can remove the antagonist and do that experiment. So
goes to show you a tiny little RNA insect virus, and you'd think, well, it's what are you going to learn from it? And the answer is, well, lots of things.
This is a virus that does not infect people, right?
Right.
It infects insects and mice, rodents. And people have worked on it for many years, and so it's an example of how you have to do basic research to learn things.
Absolutely.
Not just working on human pathogens.
Absolutely.
Roland, by the way, I don't want to go on a sidetrack. Well, I do, actually.
Why not?
Roland was a big influence in my career. I had lots of great conversations with him, and, you know, he's retired now, and he lives up in North.
He lives in Rhinelander, Wisconsin,
right.
Way up north.
So he has agreed. I'm going to go visit him in the spring when the snow melts. And he's agreed to let me do a one-on-one TWiV and explore his history. That should be fun.
Well, that'd be great. The spring. That'd be like May or June or something.
Yeah, that's right. And he's going to take me on a tour through the forest, and I'll bring a camera, and he can explain. He's a ranger of some sort,
Forester.
Right? Forester.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So that's cool. Then after that, you did a postdoc?
I went back to California, San Diego, and I worked with Michael Buckmeyer, and learned a lot about doing independent science there at Scripps. It's a wonderful place. And from there I came here to this department and have been here
ever since.
Yeah.
So you did coronavirus in Michael's laboratory?
I did.
And you came here, and we have two coronavirologists who have spent their entire careers here. I would guess more than 20 years for both of you, right?
That's true. Mm-hmm. That's true. The department grows on you. It's a wonderful place.
Mm-hmm.
And you have no intention of leaving, right?
We're always open to really good offers.
Okay.
Our chair is right here, sitting right here. So We won't answer that question.
It's been known when people appear on TWiV that they get job offers, so you just never know. It's called the TWiV bump. You never heard the Colbert bump.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
So we have the TWiV bump, and you can certainly get it.
Hey, thanks, Vince.
You're welcome. Okay, so let's talk a little virology. I wanted to get your thoughts on this. You know, SARS emerged just over 10 years ago now, right? In my view of coronas, before that, it was kind of a sleepy field. I don't mean to insult either of you, but would that be an accurate perception?
Well, in my view, it was a small but exciting field.
Okay.
And so I think the reason I went into it is because it was such an interesting virus. It was, you know, the largest positive strand RNA virus that we know of. It had a very interesting nested set of subgenomic messenger RNAs, and it was very controversial about how those RNAs were replicated. And then exactly how this large RNA maintained its genetic integrity was a really interesting question. So I think there was many people in the field who thought that this was a great model system to look at interesting questions in virology. And then, honestly, in my grants, I'd say, and there's many different, every species has their own coronavirus. It's possible that these could emerge. I'm studying these viral proteases because you could eventually need a protease inhibitor. And then lo and behold, SARS emerged out of a bat population into humans and became a highly pathogenic virus. And all those things I had been writing in my basic science grants actually were valid, you know, which was kind of an interesting occurrence.
So pre-SARS, both of you worked on mouse hepatitis virus.
We did. Mm-hmm. We still do.
And which is the model corona.
Right.
But there were, before SARS, and still are, other human coronaviruses, right?
Oh, certainly, yes. I mean, in the 1960s, there were two human coronaviruses identified, OC43 and 229E. They still are the viruses that are probably the most prevalent in the human population. They just cause relatively mild disease.
Common colds.
Right.
Infections.
Mm-hmm. So rhinos are probably still the most common cause of common colds, but coronas are right after that.
Okay.
And then after SARS was discovered, there was two additional endemic human coronaviruses discovered, NL63, it was discovered in the Netherlands, but it turns out to be worldwide in distribution. And then HKU1 was also discovered to be another human coronavirus. And now that we know about these, there's a very, I don't know if you've talked on TWiV about the viral array that's now used for hospital diagnostics. There's a very interesting system where you can take a respiratory sample and then use a PCR method to look at, I think it's now up to over 20 different pathogens simultaneously. And lo and behold, lots of people have coronaviruses, and lots of people come to the doctor because of coronavirus.
Commercially available kit to do this.
Right.
It's now a company called BioFire.
So pre-SARS, did we suspect that coronas had originated, or at least some of them, in bats? Not at all.
Maybe not. We might have had some suspicion that there could be highly pathogenic coronaviruses because, you know, there were pig and cow and bird coronaviruses that were highly lethal.
Right,
so
right.
We had that suspicion.
I think the whole bat connection is relatively around SARS and after SARS.
I think it
came with DNA sequencing abilities that allowed us to discover more viruses.
I think with the number of bat coronavirus genomes there are now, 20 or 30 or so, the evidence that bats are the reservoirs for most coronaviruses, at least the alpha and beta coronaviruses, is pretty good.
Well, I think it's also so interesting that so many different highly pathogenic viruses seem to have originated in bats. So, you know, the Nipah and Hendra negative strand RNA viruses seem to have bat origins. Coronaviruses seem to have bat origins. So this whole idea that we need to look out in the wildlife and see what kind of viruses are there as potentially emerging pathogens, and also just to increase our understanding of all of the genomes that are out there, I think that's going to be helpful for the field.
So I knew the people in the corona field before SARS because they're positive stranded, not the people, the viruses, right? And so I followed the work. But it seemed to me that when SARS emerged, all of them suddenly became globally much more visible. And so what was the effect of SARS on your research for Susan? What happened? Did you start working on it?
Immediately. As soon as the announcement, I remember this day. So, well, first there was the time where I was sitting, it was the Saturday, March 15th, 2003. I was reading the New York Times, and I said to my husband, oh, look, there's a virus in Asia that's infecting hundreds. I'm going to clip this article out because I think it might be important for my medical students. Mm-hmm. And then like 2 weeks later, it was announced that it was a coronavirus. And I immediately contacted Paul Rota at the CDC. He was incredibly gracious. He invited me down to his lab, and we set up a collaboration that was a wonderful collaboration. And we immediately, the NIH made clones available, mm-hmm. because of course SARS is a BSL-3 agent, and we don't have BSL-3 facilities here, but you can work with cDNA clones. So they made cDNA clones available. We immediately synthesized pieces of the genome, made antibodies to those pieces, and identified replicase components. And I think it was very similar for you too, Tom, right? Didn't you?
Maybe our move was a little more gradual, but I do remember the change that occurred in our field, because we had a meeting, I think it was in the Netherlands, mm-hmm. in 2003 or 4, and it was very easy to tell that our sleepy field had just grown tremendously. There were three times as many attendees at our international coronavirus conference that year.
I think also the number of publications in the field
went skyrocketed.
Oh, yeah. It's in the thousands now, mm-hmm. for SARS.
And has that, so SARS went away within 2 years,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Has not come back, but the field continues to work on the virus.
Yes, and also I think work on a number of different model viruses. Mm-hmm. I think with the advent of SARS, then came this understanding that there was additional human coronaviruses, NL63 and HKU1, and this recognition that coronaviruses likely emerge from bats, which was huge, and so a big understanding from that. And then this big question is, why is SARS so pathogenic and 229E and OC43 cause common colds? And I think that's really a fundamentally important question that's driving the field. What are the factors that contribute to viral pathogenesis? Why don't we have really good vaccines? Why don't we have really good antivirals? And that's the questions that are continuing to really drive the basic research.
So the same questions apply to influenza, right?
Absolutely.
There are high pathogenic and low pathogenic strains, and understanding why is a big question. And for influenza, there are a number of animal models that can be used to study. Are there animal models for SARS, for example, or any of the other coronas that can be used?
Yeah,
there
well,
are.
Do you want to talk about transgenic mice?
Well, there's, I mean, way it's ancient history. Well, maybe history. It's, I don't know, 8 or 10 year old history. But it is, the early animal models for SARS involved getting the human receptor into mice, right, and that would mm-hmm. sensitize mice. And depending on where the human receptor is expressed, there'd be variable sorts of outcomes on SARS challenge. And those models were, I would say, pretty good, but it seems to me, at least, that the superior animal model now involves using a mouse-adapted SARS coronavirus that the coronaviruses, plus-strand RNA viruses, they're genetically plastic, and so applied selective pressures will fix mutations that are, you know, suitable for the experimentalist, let's say. And so by edging the human SARS coronavirus onto mouse cells or mouse organs, you can get a mouse-adapted SARS. That's Ralph Barrick's work, and
yes,
we've talked
about that. I realize now that one of his postdocs, Matt Freeman, has been on TWiV many times and mm-hmm. told us about that model as well. Mm-hmm. So ferrets are not an animal model used for coronaviruses, right?
I think they are. If ferrets are infectable, but my view is always go to the simplest, smallest, least expensive animal that you can that doesn't bite you as much. And so I think it's really ferrets bite. Mm. And so I think it's best, and we can make the most progress and keep our people the most healthy by staying with models that are inexpensive and also realistic. Right. I think the mouse adapted strains are very good models for coronavirus. And now you have a number of different transgenic mice that you can use, and you can really learn a lot about the pathogen-host interaction by using mouse-adapted virus strains and mm-hmm. different knockout mice.
So whenever I have a coronavirologist on TWiV, I ask them this question, and it's, why did SARS stop spreading? Why didn't it establish itself in humans like influenza and just keep occurring, and like the other coronas? Why is it gone?
My speculation would be that one would have to credit the healthcare community for that.
And communication. The communication is a whole different ball game in 2003 than it was in 1918, right?
No, the quarantine, in Canada at least, the quarantine measures were very aggressive. Mm-hmm. And I really think that contributed, so.
But there is the fact that it did not establish itself in humans, such like influenza, where it can recur every year on a seasonal basis. Something stopped that as well, right?
Well, I think the really important thing was that evidently there were no asymptomatic carriers mm-hmm. of SARS. So when you got, if people acquire SARS, they immediately, or when the virus starts to replicate, they start to have a high fever. And they're most infectious to others at the time when they have the high fever. Mm-hmm. So public health measures could work because you can identify and quarantine those individuals with high fever. And they were smart, they individually quarantined them. Like in the 1918 flu, they would put people in huge open wards and send in hospital workers and family mm-hmm. workers mm-hmm. into these areas with people with, you know, influenza. So it was just asking for transmission issues, whereas with SARS now, and the other thing that happened in Hong Kong, for instance, the government said, okay, we're going to shut down the schools, we're going to ask you if you have a fever to stay home, and people did it, and people cooperated, and that stopped human-to-human transmission.
That's mm-hmm. when the fever scanners were put in airports.
Right? Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
If you had a fever, you had to go back to your hotel.
Yeah, it's true.
Mm-hmm. So the, I mean, what surprises me is that there haven't been more zoonotic transmissions from bats to people. The meat markets that were implicated in SARS emergence, they were initially closed, but I think they're back again, right?
I think there's new regulations. I'm not totally familiar with the regulations in China, but I think that there's much more government supervision now of those wild animal markets, and they really, the whole idea is to reduce the incidence of cohabiting or co-housing wild species with each other where they could transmit a virus from one to the other.
Because for H7N9 influenza, which is currently ongoing in China, the live poultry markets were implicated mm-hmm. last year. They closed them down, transmission stopped, and then they reopened them not long ago, and now we have lots of cases.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
it seems that these are a prime place to transmit infections, and we should shut them all down. But apparently it's not easy to do.
It's not mm-hmm. easy to do when people want to buy their chickens.
Yeah.
Right.
So you have to appreciate the American shrink-wrapped products that mm-hmm. don't transmit, mm-hmm. even though it's kind of sterile, they don't transmit infections. I tell people, in New York City in the Bronx, there's an Italian neighborhood called Arthur Avenue, really good restaurants, and they used to have a live chicken market. You would go in, there were stacks of cages with live chickens. You would pick it, they would slaughter it, and you'd walk out carrying. And they stopped that 5 years ago, I think in part because of the zoonotic transmissions that mm-hmm. go on in China. So now recently, a year or so ago, we have an emergence of a second corona in the Middle East, the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus. Has this had a similar effect on the field as SARS, giving it a jolt?
Well, I think the good news
by now.
No, I think the good news is the field is much more prepared.
Yeah.
So we I don't know if your audience knows, it's Middle East Respiratory Syndrome virus. The first report came out of Saudi Arabia. A mm-hmm. very astute physician recognized that his patient had a very severe pneumonia, and it wasn't anything that his clinical micro lab could recognize. So he sent the sample to Abe Osterhout's lab, I mm-hmm. believe, and Ron Fouché in the Netherlands, and they did sequencing and realized it was another coronavirus, but not SARS. And so that started this whole identification, looking for patients with severe pneumonia of unknown origin, and then the recognition that a number of people in the Middle East fit this criteria. And the response by the National Institutes of Health has been very aggressive. Tony Fauci called a meeting of coronavirologists and other experts in the field, and we discussed, you know, what are the biggest issues? And transmission, of course, was the biggest question. Where was this virus coming from, and how aggressively was it going to transmit within the human population? And what we've seen is evidently this virus is not highly transmissible. It's different than SARS, mm-hmm. because when people are exposed, there are family members that have acquired the infection, okay. but it's not like SARS, where numerous people in the family would get it.
So the idea is that maybe it originated in a bat, mm-hmm. and camels now have been somehow, mm-hmm. They have antibodies, and they've isolated some viral sequences from camels.
I think a lot of MERS virus sequence has been isolated from camels.
So what do you think happened? Who was first, the bat, the human, or the camel? Sounds like a joke.
Yeah. The bat and the camel went to the bar.
Probably the best speculation, once again, is that bats are the reservoirs, and the intermediate hosts can vary somewhat widely. Civet cats and raccoon dogs in the case of SARS and camels in the case of MERS. And one always wonders what the, what are the determinants mm-hmm. on the host for transmissibility.
Mm-hmm. And I think it's not quite clear whether some people got it from bats and other people got it from camels. Did it have to go through camels? I think it's still an open question. The serology suggests that many camels have experienced MERS coronavirus in the past. And they have blood samples from like 10 years ago, and these camels are antibody positive, and camels in Spain are antibody positive, but yet we haven't had any MERS cases in Spain. So
these could be related viruses, but not MERS itself.
Correct, right? Mm-hmm. Correct.
So you really need to get viral sequences out now.
You do.
Absolutely.
I know the camel has been the best so far besides humans, and that there's just one isolation of a small sequence from a bat.
Correct. Right. That's nearly identical
to
MERS.
My colleague Ian Lipkin is working very hard to look at the bats
mm-hmm.
in the region to find them, but I suppose eventually we'll know what happened.
And it was surprising. I looked up, I Googled, bats in Saudi Arabia. If you do that, there's a guy's dissertation. It turns out there's 26 different species of bats in Saudi Arabia. Mm-hmm. Who knew?
Right.
And so it's really...
And a lot of camels also.
And a lot of camels.
Right. Yeah. So it has not transmitted well, as you say, from human to human. Do you think that it will remain localized, or is there potential to spread globally? Because clearly a WHO is worried
mm-hmm.
about that, and I suppose vaccines or antivirals are being sought for that. What are your thoughts about that?
When the when the SARS transited from animals to humans, there were changes fixed into the virus in the spike, the part that binds to the receptors, mm-hmm. and elsewhere, and those are fixative changes that enhance the capacity of the virus to transmit amongst humans.
Right.
And so it isn't unreasonable to suspect that something similar could happen with MERS. I would imagine the virus would have to have a residence time in the human population to experiment, if you will, evolutionarily, to generate more highly transmissible variants. That's the concern.
Yeah.
And I think that's possible.
Of course, whether it's going to happen or not is anybody's guess.
Yeah, right.
So I suppose you just have to be ready.
Yes,
right.
I think that's the important thing. And I think there have been now support for vaccine efforts for MERS. And we're working on antiviral drugs mm-hmm. for MERS, protease inhibitors. A number of people are working on replicase inhibitors. And this whole idea that, yes, we do need more basic understanding of what will make good vaccines, good antivirals to this family of coronaviruses, because who knows what's going to be the next one that emerges, right?
So this is an interesting problem, because here you have two diseases, SARS, which is gone, and MERS, which is pretty minimal in the global sense, 100, almost 200 cases, I think,
mm-hmm,
not even.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
How do you test a vaccine or an antiviral when you don't really have a disease population to test it in, right? This must think about this all the time.
Well, it's so clear that this is why basic research in animal models is so important. So the classic one for coronaviruses is mouse hepatitis virus that infects mice, and it's been studied for you know over 40 years, and it is a really good model system, BSL-2 virus that only infects mm-hmm. mice, not graduate students or postdocs. And you can really, there's a reverse genetic system for it. You can introduce mutations. You can study immune responses. So that's been the workhorse of the field, I'd say.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, the FDA requires two animal models to license something, and so you would need a second one. I know this only because I recently talked to Dennis Ruby, who's mm-hmm. trying to have a anti-smallpox antiviral approved by the FDA, and they don't have two animal models, and it's a real problem. So,
well, there's ferrets, yeah, and then there's also rhesus macaques. Okay. So macaques are a great model. They've been working, I don't know if you've been out to the labs in Montana. They do beautiful.
I'm going this summer.
They do beautiful work out there on the rhesus macaques, so you can talk to them. But that's an expensive and difficult model. Yeah. And so you need to start small and test something effective and then move your way up. That's sort mm-hmm. of the classic view of the field, I'd say.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I heard the marmoset is a good model for MERS. Marmosets, tiny
small
little
things,
300 gram primates.
So we do not have a SARS vaccine, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Are any still in development at any level?
There's been a number of vaccines tested that have shown efficacy in animal models. To my knowledge, I don't know that is there a stockpile somewhere?
No. Of candidate SARS vaccine?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Well, I think there's many, many candidates from live attenuated viruses mm-hmm. to subunit vaccines, you know, representing portions of the S protein to vectored vaccines like the Barrack Lab is interested in alpha virus vectors mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. express N and S. So there's a wide number. Each one has their own, vaccine approach has its own benefits and caveats.
Right? Well, in the absence of an ongoing disease, it's hard to, companies are not interested.
Exactly, right? Pharmaceutical companies aren't interested, right.
So it would have to be government funding agencies, and then there's always a priority. What do we deal with? Current infections or things that are potential? You always have to balance all of this. You talk
Absolutely.
With people who work in the government, they always will tell you this.
Mm-hmm.
So now we have MERS, which is ongoing in people, not a large number, but is a potential to spread. So I suppose similar efforts are going on there.
I think so. It is challenging, right? Because just like with flu, the target's always moving. The vaccine target is always moving. So if MERS increases a little and we get a vaccine mm-hmm. to temper MERS, we wonder whether those vaccines will work in the
right.
future epidemic. But the principles that are laid down, they hold.
Well, that's the key to, that was the key to making anti-HIV
mm-hmm.
Antivirals. We had this long history of retrovirus research, which had said the proteases are important for this and this, and that immediately could be applied to making anti-HIV drugs.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
Perfect.
Exactly.
Right. Perfect. So let's talk a little bit about what you guys do and tell us what your interests are. And Susan, I know you have always been interested in the proteases.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us all about those.
Okay, so absolutely. So coronaviruses are these positive strand RNA viruses that make long, the replicase polyprotein needs to be processed by viral proteases. And there's one called the papain-like protease, we call PL-PRO. So it's been a super attractive target for antiviral drug development, and I've been very fortunate to collaborate with a crystallographer, Andy Messicar, who's at Purdue University, and they were able to solve the crystal structure of this enzyme. And of course that's, you know, very helpful for antiviral drug development, but also it opened our eyes to a whole new aspect. So the crystallography revealed that this enzyme is not only a papain-like protease, but it's also of the family of what are called ubiquitin-specific proteases that remove ubiquitin. They have deubiquitinating activity. They remove post-translational modifications from cellular proteins.
So this is the MHV protease?
The MHV protease,
SARS?
And the SARS protease, mm-hmm. and the NL63. So this is a common mm-hmm. theme in the coronavirus proteases.
I presume MERS also has this.
MERS
protease.
Has this. We just recently published a paper that showed that the MERS papain-like protease also has deubiquitinating activity. And so the question is, why has this virus protease evolved to be multifunctional?
Can I ask you, for our listeners, why are they called papain-like?
Because papain is has this enzyme has been crystallized and is the model enzyme of the field. Mm-hmm. And so enzymes are categorized according to their active sites. The enzymes, this has a catalytic triad of a cysteine, histidine, and aspartic acid that have a similar structure. So in order to study enzyme function, people categorized enzymes according to similar active sites. So that's our enzyme has a similar active site.
So do humans have papain-like proteases?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Humans have papain-like proteases. Animals have papain-like proteases.
Okay. So if you make an inhibitor to the viral protease, papain-like protease, it would have to be specific and not have any inhibitory effects on us.
Absolutely. Right? So that's a really good question. So that's the whole trick in the field is, you know, how do you tailor an inhibitor to be specific to your enzyme? And coronaviruses have a unique area upstream of the active site of the protease that we've identified antiviral drugs that will bind into this loop, mm-hmm. and inhibit access to the active site. And that's sort of a unique target that the proteases have.
And you can check some human enzymes to see if they have an effect on those, right?
We've done that, absolutely. That's critical that you have a unique inhibitory activity.
So you have several compounds that can inhibit the protease activity of these viral proteases. Do they also inhibit the deubiquitinating activity?
Yes, they do. Yes, they do.
Same active site.
Mm-hmm.
So the papain activity is for cleaving the viral polyprotein.
Correct.
So it's like a picornavirus. It makes a long protein, and the viral proteases chop it up.
Right.
And what's the deubiquitinating part for? Is that for the virus or the host?
That's the critical question. So we're really actively investigating that right now, and we really want to know why has this enzyme evolved to have both protease and deubiquitinating activity. And our hypothesis is that it somehow is involved in regulating the virus's ability to turn off innate immune activation. Mm-hmm. So when viruses enter cells, there's a number of pattern recognition receptors and things that say, that turn on this signal in the cell that says, danger, there's a virus here. You know, you want to put up as many antiviral defenses. But if the virus has acquired the ability to turn off that signal, then the virus can, you know, replicate more efficiently. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to actually turn off the DUB activity so that we can test the hypothesis. Our prediction would be that if we turn off the DUB activity, the virus would be less pathogenic. So that's what we're working right now to try to do.
So your idea is the DUB activity is trying to overcome the innate response, mm-hmm. which in part is to put ubiquitin on viral proteins.
It could be either ubiquitin on viral proteins, or it could be ubiquitin on sensors, on signal transduction molecules that are turned on in order to turn on interferon.
Right, so something like RIG-I needs to be ubiquitinated to sense RNA.
Correct.
And then the other part is, if you ubiquitinated a viral protein, mm-hmm. that would target
it. It could go for degradation, and that would be detrimental. So maybe the effect is to make sure that viral proteins don't get deubiquitinated.
So yeah,
or it could be a surprise. We got to be open to that.
You don't know until you do the experiment.
Absolutely.
Right? You can't predict everything. So you're trying, I presume, to make viruses that lack the DUB
Absolutely.
Activity.
Mm-hmm. That's what we're trying to again.
And this is with MHV, I presume, right?
Absolutely. With MHV and also with SARS.
And for SARS, you have to go to a BSL-3 somewhere.
Yes, right? Yes. We, again, collaborate with Andy Messicart at Purdue University and use the BSL-3 there.
Mm-hmm. Are you going to do it with MERS as well?
We have already, as I said, published on the deubiquitinating activity of MERS. And I think we'll get more mileage out of actually the mouse model system because there's no animal model yet for MERS. And so I think we want to, again, do the basic science, test it in the model system, and then go to a right. system like SARS or MERS.
So I noticed also you work on this porcine coronavirus that has joined us in the U.S. not too long ago.
Yes, porcine epidemic diarrhea virus. Mm-hmm. It's a huge pathogen of the pork industry. This virus infects piglets, and it's very high mortality in piglets. And so, again, no vaccine, and you don't give antivirals to pigs, but very important to control. So they're trying to use essentially public health measures to control this porcine epidemic diarrhea virus and limit it from going from pig farm to pig farm,
right.
and really trying to isolate it. So a big question is, you know, how is it getting from farm to farm? If you aren't transmitting pigs, it's got to be coming on the people, or it's got to be coming some other way.
Yeah.
And so that's a huge question in the field.
So this porcine virus, PEV, right?
Mm-hmm. PEDV.
Has a dub
activity? It does. It also has a dub activity.
Which you think is involved in the same mm-hmm. antagonism of innate immunity, right?
We think so.
And mm-hmm. I'm sorry, did you say MERS has dub also?
MERS has dub also.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I saw lots of plates of plaque assays. In your laboratory.
I know this is a favorite of yours, Vincent. your TWiV audience must be familiar with you know, you can't see a virus, right? You can't see a virus with your eyes. So how do you tell if a virus is infecting a cell? So if the virus infects a cell, it'll kill it. And if you have a whole lawn of cells and the virus infects the first cell and the virus spreads to the neighboring cells, it'll kill an area and that produces a plaque, which is a great visual for you to see viral infection. And also, a thing that's really important is that you can tell a lot about the virus by what kind of plaque it makes. So my student Anna Mielik was studying a virus, and she found that the plaques were a little different. And she said, you know, these plaques aren't quite the same. What's going on here? And so one of the things that can happen is that a mutation can affect can be a temperature sensitive. If you raise the temperature of the incubator or this place where the virus is replicating, the plaque size can change. And so she noticed that when she raised the temperature, tried to make infect cells at the higher temperature with this virus, it was unable to make plaques. So it was a temperature sensitive virus. And make a long story short, it turns out that virus is actually a really good vaccine candidate. It will infect mice but not cause disease, and elicits a very complete immune response, protective to challenge. So this was partly because she noticed differences in the ability of the virus to make plaques. So
it's a great assay.
It's a great assay.
Should make a wall of SARS.
That's what I need to do.
or whatever you're going to call it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Save up the plates and stack them up, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We do. I was surprised to see the 6-well plates. We do the same. When I used to do them, years ago, I used to use individual 6-centimeter plates.
They
My
fall
students
down too
said,
much. Yeah.
You're crazy. There's way too many plates to handle. And I said, well, I don't want to use 6-well plates. But they do now, and they work very well.
And they stack and make walls really
well. Yeah, they stack beautifully. Absolutely. So one of your goals is to make an antiviral, which hopefully would be put through the approval process and so forth. To do that, do you have to work with pharmaceutical industry, or how does that work?
Yeah, I think that's, you know, right now we're in the very basic science stages, and because SARS and MERS are not economically important viruses, the pharmaceutical industries are not yet engaged. But the other thing that happens with basic science is that if we can make, I think one of the important contributions that we've made is to understanding that our protease inhibitors that we've made can be specific. So there's like 100 enzymes that are similar to our enzyme that are known. And our inhibitor, the worry was, you know, will inhibitors inhibit all 100 of these enzymes?
Sure.
But we demonstrated that we could inhibit just our enzyme and not, we haven't tested all 99 others, but there is precedent now that you can make specific inhibitors for the family of ubiquitin-specific proteases. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a contribution to the field.
Right. So one thing we've learned with these monotherapies is that you get drug resistance very quickly with most RNA viruses, HIV. And for HIV, we learned we need to do combined therapy.
Right.
Could you make multiple inhibitors and do that? Would that make sense?
We're working on that. We have multiple targets. There's two different proteases. So we have a papain-like protease and the 3C-like protease. So we're working on multiple targets. But another interesting thing is when you get drug-resistant mutants, two things can happen. Either they can retain pathogenesis, or the drug-resistant mutant could be less pathogenic.
Sure.
And so Xufeng Deng in my lab has been working on these studies, and it has shown that some of our drug-resistant mutants are actually attenuated for pathogenesis. Mm. So the mutations that are required to make it drug-resistant weaken the virus. So you select for a virus that is less pathogenic.
If it turned out to be the case for all drug resistance, that would be great.
No, but you have to test each one, right?
Because for influenza, resistance to the neuraminidase inhibitors does not interfere with transmission and pathogenesis.
And HIV it doesn't
as well.
Either.
Yeah.
Right. But so that's why you have to really evaluate each one.
Yeah, because there are probably only so many ways to get resistance. If you could test all and show that, in fact, they are attenuated, that would be fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is there anything that I missed that we should cover?
I think that's great.
All right. Mm-hmm. We'll move on to Tom. I know you're interested in
the early steps
of infection, which we used to be also.
I can tell you about a recent effort that we've made, and we think we can contribute a little to understanding this new MERS coronavirus and the way that it transmits amongst animals in the Middle East and people. And I think that you know, or maybe your audience already knows, that the receptor for the MERS coronavirus was identified about a year ago or so by a group in the Netherlands, excellent coronavirus
really
group.
Very fast. Within months after
Very fast.
The virus. Amazing.
The technique is quite simple. Actually, you take a portion of the spike protein, that's the sticky part of the virus, and you affix it to an immunoglobulin FC, and you create a immunoadhesin, and you capture the receptor protein or proteins, and through reverse genetics you can then get the gene for the receptor, and it's quite straightforward. So that receptor turns out to be an ectopeptidase. It's called dipeptidyl peptidase 4, and if you just line up human DPP4 and animal DPP4s, you can see variability, actually variability throughout the entire 800 or so amino acid protein. But again, very quickly, groups in China co-crystallized the spike protein of MERS with the DPP4, whose structure was already known. And so the contact points just were between the virus and the receptor were just immediately revealed. Goes to show you, when people want to make some headway on a new pathogen, they will do it, and do it very quickly.
I think a new pathogen is a great catalyst for that kind of work.
It's really remarkable. And there's good labs.
This is an ectopeptide, in other words, on the cell surface, but it's a peptidase. What does it do normally?
Cleaves small peptides, signaling-related peptides and hormones, and cleaves off the, C-terminal pieces. And
so in humans, this is in the respiratory tract?
It is.
Anywhere else? Or
Maybe in the kidneys.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
but
it's in the tract.
The DPP4 is on non-ciliated cells of the respiratory tract.
So this is the MERS receptor.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
If I remember, the SARS receptor is an enzyme also, right?
It is also an ectopeptidase, and there's yet another coronavirus, 229E, that uses aminopeptidase N, yet another ectopeptidase, as a receptor. But curiously, you can eliminate the ectopeptidase enzyme activities for all those receptors, and doesn't seem to impede their ability to support virus entry. So there's something we don't quite understand about, why it is that these viruses would evolve to select these ectopeptidases for entry.
but it's not the enzyme activity either way.
Yeah. Our favorite idea would be that all these ectopeptidases are housed within particular little membrane microdomains on the plasma membrane that also contain other virus entry supporting components like proteases, which are needed to drive the fusion and entry of the virus.
But not all coronaviruses bind these ectopeptidases, right? There are others.
Our classic exception is the mouse hepatitis virus that we study, which uses an immunoglobulin-like molecule as a receptor.
Right.
So, there are exceptions.
So when we identify the polio receptor as an immunoglobulin-like molecule, the HIV receptor had just been identified as CD4, which is an Ig, and then rhinovirus at the same time.
Right.
It's those three viruses, and so Dan Littman, I think, wrote a review article saying all viruses must bind to Ig-like receptors.
Yeah,
this is just showing you how we get influenced by results when it's too early.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But the why
questions
are hard.
We're only seeing part of the picture.
Yeah. Sure.
We don't
sure.
know why. So you've worked with the MERS receptor?
Have, and the thing I was going to say is that we knew that 6 or 8 months ago the mouse form of the DPP4, it does not function as a receptor, and we made our own SFC proteins and demonstrated indeed the SFC will not bind to the mouse receptor. So we thought, well, we'll regenerate receptor activity from a mouse receptor backbone by putting in the spike binding parts from a camel receptor or a goat receptor or a bat and so on and so forth, and ask, are there affinity differences between these different animal DPP4s that might help explain something about the transmission pathways of this virus to humans? And so it turns out that human and camel and horse DPP4s are really quite similar in their affinity for the current human MERS spike. And the goat's a little less effective, and bat very much less effective at binding. So we would figure that from bats, which might be the reservoir for the virus, there'd be intermediate hosts whose receptors are intermediate in affinity between bat and human.
So if the virus is in bats, it's not likely to be able to directly infect
people. We wouldn't think so. We would think there'd probably be an intermediate just based on these receptor spike interactions that we're studying.
So you can, in theory, make a transgenic mouse with the human DPP?
You can indeed.
Have people done that?
So we worked with Stanley Perlman, a close colleague at the University of Iowa, and it's mostly Stanley's work, but I could tell you that he and us have made adenovirus vectors that encode for the human DPP4, and we can transduce mouse lungs with these adenoviruses to overproduce the human DPP4, and that does sensitize the mouse lung to MERS coronavirus replication. So I would look at that as a quick a way to establish a small animal model that's much faster than transgenic technology.
Absolutely, and you have no side effects associated with the transgene. We worry about position effects or other things in a line, whereas this you can infect a different batch of mice each time.
Right. The challenge is, and I'm sure these challenges exist for good many viruses, but the challenge is to generate an animal model that recapitulates the human disease, and that involves far more than simply sensitizing an animal to the replication of the virus. These mice that overproduce the human DPP4, they will produce copious yields of MERS coronavirus, but there's little or no disease.
So there's no pathology in the lung whatsoever.
There is pathology, but there's not the kind of weight loss and ultimately death that you'd see in the, for example, the mouse-adapted SARS coronavirus model.
Yeah, and there's probably no transmission, or hasn't been looked at.
I wouldn't know.
Because that's another component that we realize is really important in flu. There are mouse models, but they don't transmit well. The ferret transmits well, which is why it's used. Yeah. So if you really want to understand that, I mean, there, as you say, there are different components. You could look at the pathology and transmission.
It will be really interesting to see what happens with the production of mouse-adapted MERS. Mm-hmm. It's not really all about entry. Our lab is interested in entry, of course, but there's certainly other genes that are going to contribute to pathogenesis.
So MERS genome, when it gets into a mouse cell, will replicate.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Whereas SARS genome, well, it is the same with SARS?
Same with all coronaviruses. If you transfect the RNA is infectious.
It will replicate.
It will replicate.
So mouse cells are permissive, which is the same for polio, which always surprises me because we don't know that polio has ever infected any mouse in history, yet the mouse cell is completely able to, to deal with it. And it seems to be the same with the coronavirus.
Yes.
But you said the mouse model for SARS, they had the mouse adapt the virus. So that's because there's something beyond permissivity that is important to replicate in mice.
The mouse-adapted SARS coronavirus does have mutations in its spike, but it has mutations elsewhere in the what's called the, you know, the NSPs, non-structural proteins.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you and Stanley wrote a commentary on the dipeptyl peptidase paper last year when
it
came out. Yeah, we talked about that on TWiV as
Oh, good.
Right? It's a nice article. Mm-hmm. So you also are interested in how the whole entry process works. Right,
We are. We're certainly, you know, we look at the receptors as key restriction factors, of course, but another one that might be equally or maybe more important are proteases. And we're interested in transmembrane serine type proteases that may well reside very close to the receptors to cleave the spike proteins after receptor binding. And then, you know,
on the cell surface
and activate fusion and entry. It's very similar to influenza virus entry, you know.
So for these viruses, does endocytosis play a role? Or can they enter at the cell surface?
So that's a good question. Most of the coronaviruses have an obligate requirement for endocytosis because they're greatly inhibited by inhibitors of endosome acidification.
Okay, so endocytosis as well as low pH are required.
Yeah.
Which for polio, we don't need low pH, we just need endocytosis.
Right.
So the idea is it gets endocytosis, the pH drops, and then the spike catalyzes fusion?
The spike catalyzes fusion, and the catalysts necessary to turn the spike into an efficient catalyst of membrane coalescence. The factors required would be proteases most definitely, and then acidification at some stage, either before or after the proteolysis.
So that's interesting. The cleavage happens during the infection that activates the fusion activity of the spike? Is that right?
During the entry.
Entry, yeah.
Yeah.
Which for flu is different. It happens during exit.
Yeah, but for low path flu, there are roles for proteolysis of the hemagglutinin during entry. So
are there other proteins in the virion that participate in entry besides the spike?
I don't think so.
No, that's it.
I don't think so. It could be that the efficiency of entries increased a little bit by the way in which the spike is embedded in a native virus.
Okay.
But that would contribute modestly, I think.
So one thing that's always intrigued me about the coronas is that they're plus-stranded RNAs, but they're coated with protein, right, in the virion?
They are.
Is it nucleoprotein? Or
nucleocapsid protein.
So the RNA gets in the cytoplasm, it needs to be translated, right?
Yes.
What happens to this nucleocapsid protein? Do we know?
I don't think so.
Off? Does it stay on? Do the ribosomes push it away? No.
We just don't know. I think it's not clear. And translation occurs very efficiently because you get translation of the replicase polyprotein very instantly after entry of the RNA. And that nucleocapsid protein isn't required, so you can transfect naked RNA and elicit the entire life cycle. So
can you delete the nucleoprotein gene from the virus? Will it replicate?
No.
I don't think so.
No, it don't make particles. So is it needed for assembly?
Absolutely.
Is that because, in part, the genome is so big? Because the other plus-strand viruses don't have any... You know, coronas break the rule. I try and teach by rules, and I say clustrin RNAs are naked except for coronas. Why did you have to do that? Do we understand?
I don't know.
No.
I think that there's in assembly there's a main organizing protein. It's called the membrane protein, which communicates, if you will, with the other pieces, the nucleoprotein and the spike, to bring the parts together.
Yeah, so it's a packaging issue, which again might relate to the size of the genome, 30 plus kilobases.
It could. It could. It's a lot to package in there.
So, can you make smaller replicons, say, that are significantly smaller that can replicate? Might not need the end protein. That might be one way to look at it.
You can, so defective interfering particles, coronaviruses make defective interfering particles, and you can put the packaging signal on those DI particles and they'll package efficiently. You do need nucleocapsid protein in there as a helper component.
Okay.
So I think it's still required.
Okay.
To my knowledge, you can't package naked RNA.
All right. Well, thank you for
sure.
I've learned a lot today. You guys have any questions? I'm not done yet, though. You want to hear some emails?
Sure.
Does anybody here listen to TWiV? Raise your hand. One.
Hey,
oh,
no,
hey, that's pretty good.
Yeah, that's many. Good.
Well, we always
it
have
correlates
email.
With a younger age.
Yes, I notice. Yeah. But notice how old I am, and I do this. we always have cool emails, and I wanted to read a couple to you. Is that okay? You guys have time? First one is from Jim, who writes, there is a TED Talk by Mark Kendall about an advance in using nanotechnology to administer vaccines. With this method, there are several advantages. Breaks the cold chain. Vaccine can be stored out of the refrigerator. Reduces the dose to achieve a significant immune response. Gives an earlier response to the vaccine by putting the vaccine in the immune active part of the skin and eliminates the pain of using a needle. I found this very interesting. Thanks a ton for all of the great podcasts. So he sent the link to a TED Talk, which is basically, I don't know if you've seen this, these are vaccine patches. They're little micro needle patches where they're put on the skin with a Band-Aid. And the needles penetrate the outer layer of the skin, deliver the antigen. And it turns out to be a really good place to put antigen because there are dendritic cells in there.
Right.
And you can formulate the vaccine in sugar so that it's very stable and just tape these onto people. And these are going to come out, I'm sure. They really are very interesting.
So these would be like virus-like particles?
I guess they would be non-infectious vaccines mostly, yeah. Either subunits or virus-like particles, yeah. So there's a TED Talk demonstrating that. It's quite interesting. So we actually talked about this on TWiV 175, so you can check this out. And this one, Susan, is for you. This one, and actually it's for both of you. It's an interesting story. This is from Matthew, who writes, thank you for the wonderful podcast. I hope all is well. I am a graduate student at Vanderbilt University.
Ah, yes.
Where the weather is currently 25 Fahrenheit minus 4 Celsius.
So that's warm.
I was listening to TWiV 267, Snow in the Headlights, the other day, and there was mention of Clara cells regarding a potential source of an HAV cleaving protease. So the idea has been for years that there are these cells in the respiratory tract called Clara cells. They make a protease, and that's what's cleaving the HA, and that's what restricts the tropism to the respiratory, because you don't find those anywhere else, okay? So it turns out this is probably not true anymore. There's some evidence that there are intracellular processing going on, but we did talk about that in that TWiV. I wanted to pass along some history of the term Clara, named after a German scientist with strong Nazi associations. The tissue he used to identify these cells was from Nazi political prisoners, which has prompted some concern about the continued use of the term Clara cell. Here's the original 2010 article that brought about the discussion. It gives us a link to an article. It would be inappropriate and impossible to unknow our knowledge about these cells. Important discoveries associated with these cells have advanced research and improved human health. The general consensus with Nazi-associated eponyms has been to replace them with more descriptive terms. That way, the knowledge is preserved without giving credit to those who obtained it unethically. Similar changes have been implemented for granulomatosis with polyangiitis, formerly Wegener's granulomatosis, and reactive arthritis, formerly Reiter's syndrome. The American Thoracic Society and many other international pulmonary societies have endorsed the change from Clara cell to club cell. And he sends a link to this article. Ethics have evolved over time, and it's hard to always criticize past science through our current lens. For instance, the early vaccinology experiments of Edward Jenner and Benjamin Jesty would likely not get IRB approval today.
No way.
Although we hold them generally in high regard. That said, the transgressions regarding Max Clara are extreme, even for early 20th century science, and it would seem best to use the term club cell to describe these cells instead. I look forward to your thoughts. So I didn't know this about Clara.
I did not know that either.
At all. Mm-mm. So I think of the HeLa cell story, where HeLa cells were taken from Henrietta Lacks with no medical consent, because that was the practice
exactly.
at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually the family found out, and there have been all kinds of controversies about how that should go and whether the family should be reimbursed and so forth. But the fact is, it was done at a time where there was no medical consent, and now we look back through the lens, as you say, mm-hmm. and I don't know, what do you think? Should we change Clara cell to another name? I'm not sure what we think about this. Yeah. I know I just put you on the spot, but should we change it?
Change the name. I would change it. That would be my vote.
I
for
think
what
it hurts
it's worth.
To change it. To
yeah,
club
I think if there's an alternative that is very that is appropriate, I think we should change it. I'm not in favor of giving any Nazi experiments any value. Although I don't think it's commonly known that's how those cells were derived.
Yeah, I mean, that now it will become more widely known mm-hmm, because mm-hmm. of this. But the problem is, of course, the literature is full of Clara cell, which you mm-hmm, can't expunge.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And there may be some confusion.
What we find also is if you change something in the field and then people start to Google it, they'll lose
some
all the alternative names. So, you know, that's just a sign of the times.
What do you guys think?
What's
should,
the vote
should we change
there?
The name? Raise your hand if you think we should change the name. Yeah, okay, most people think we should change it. All right, so there you go, Matthew. This is a great example. These listeners we have are great.
Yeah, right. It's wonderful.
Let me see if I have any more for you guys before we move on.
Sure.
So I have one from this retired biochemist in California who surfs and skis in the same day, but I'm not gonna, it's too long. I'm not going to read it. I want to make I want to make a science pick of the week, which we do every time, and I'll do one just for consistency. And a while ago, recently, it was the 30th anniversary of the Macintosh, the Apple Macintosh, mm-hmm, and I have used Apple computers my whole career, and I use an iPhone, and I have a TWiV case, of course, on my iPhone. And last time I picked a teardown of the original Mac, that beige looking box, which is really cool. So my pick this week kind of follows up on that. It's a video of Steve Jobs presenting the Macintosh. You may remember he presented it in front of a shareholder meeting and pulled it out of a bag, and he turned it on and it began talking to the audience, and everyone freaked out because this had never been done before. Well, this is actually a recording he made a week later, I think, at the Boston Computer Society, and the video is much better, and he's better at it. You know, Steve Jobs eventually became incredible at delivering keynote addresses, and we could all learn from how he gave talks. But this one is fabulous, so that's my pick of the week. And then we have a listener pick from Lance. I don't think anyone has picked the book by Nate Silver, The Signal and the Noise, Why So Many Predictions Fail But Some Don't. The author does a fantastic job explaining the science behind prediction, big data, and why our predictions models aren't very good sometime. Specifically of interest is Chapter 7, which discusses disease, mostly flu, modeling by groups at the University of Pittsburgh and the University of Chicago. Keep on doing great work, Lance. Okay, so that's our listener pick, and that will do it for TWiV 276. You can find this episode at iTunes, twiv.tv, and if you like what we do, go over to iTunes and subscribe to the podcast. And there are places where you can leave comments or star the episodes, and that helps to keep us more visible. We want people to discover us and find out how cool virology is and listen to virologists talking about it and getting excited. And that's one of the ways that you can help us. We always love getting your questions and comments. You can send them to twiv@twiv.tv. And I want to thank my two guests here at Loyola University, Susan Baker, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for coming and visiting us, Vincent.
My pleasure. And Tom Gallagher,
thank you. Thank you, Vince.
I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I think our listeners will get a lot of cool information from that. My name is Vincent Racaniello, and you can find me at virology.ws. You've been listening to This Week in Virology. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. Another TWiV is viral.